Allahu Akbar.
Bismillah walhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul uqdatum min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I hope that you all are doing well, are staying safe and healthy inshallah. On behalf of young Muslims, I'd like to welcome you all to our online symposium titled Alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My name is Zirwazi Amir, and I will be serving as your moderator for tonight. I am a young Muslims member from the New Hyde Park chapter in New York. I'm currently in my second year of optometry school. I've been involved in YM for about 7 years and currently help in the national expansion team. And I am very excited for everyone to join us for our first session tonight. Before we start, I want to give a brief introduction about Young Muslims. Young Muslims is a division of ICNA. We are a national youth organization with chapters all across the country, from the East Coast to the West Coast. Our goal as an organization is to create a safe and supportive environment for our youth. Every year, some of our members work together to hold an annual Young Muslims conference in conjunction with the ICNA convention. Although we weren't able to physically meet due to our current health situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed us to continue to spread the knowledge of the deen through this online medium. Indeed, you know, we plan, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of all planners, and alhamdulillah, we are still able to benefit through this platform. So I want to give a little quick note on how the format of this session is going to be. At the end of each talk, we will be having a small Q&A with each speaker. So please feel free to type in your questions in the Q&A section or the live comment section. And inshallah, we'll keep an eye out for your questions and have the speaker address them. So with that, we are going to move on to our next topic, titled Ramadan at Home, in which we will be discussing how to make the most of Ramadan while being in the comfort of our homes. And for this talk, we will be having Imam Siraj Wahhaj speak on this topic. Imam Siraj is a globally recognized leader with over 40 years of experience delivering riveting talks that have sparked the minds and souls of us all. He is the Imam of Masjid al-Taqwa in Brooklyn, New York. He received Imam training at Al-Qura University in 1978 and has gone on to become a national and international speaker on the message of Islam. So with that, I would like to invite Imam Siraj Wahhaj to join us.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. Rahim, alhamdulillah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu amma ba'd. Brothers and sisters, it gives me a great honor and privilege to address you tonight for a few moments to talk to you a little bit about this magnificent month that will be before us, maybe 13 days, something like that. So we're fasting, inshallah, Ramadan. What's in it for us? And fasting at home. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that there are more Muslims who go to the masjid than who do not go to the masjid? If you would do the research, you would find out the minority of the Muslims go to masjids and the majority of the Muslims don't go to the masjids. So what are we missing in this Ramadan with this corona virus trials? What are we missing? We're missing something about our community, the jama'ah, togetherness. I don't know any group, any organization, any religion that's more communal than the Muslims. We do things together. I give an example. You know, we Muslims, especially the men, try to make all their prayers in the masjid. It doesn't always happen, but we try. Let me tell you something about my masjid. I can tell you at Fajr, basically, where everybody's going to be. I'm standing behind the Imam, Sheikh Hassan, and to my left usually is a brother named Abdullah from Mauritania. And immediately to his left, or the next person, is a brother named Fatih, Rahimullah, who just passed yesterday. You know Fatih, who had the restaurant on Fulton Street next to the masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him. There's not a day that went by, not a salat that went by, except I'm talking to Brother Fatih, always talking to him, always having a smile, a wonderful personality in our community. So on my right, you're going to have a brother, Mohammed Boy from Guinea, beautiful brother. And to his right, Mohammed Abdul Bari, he's the Mu'addin of the Masjid. He's also from Guinea. And also the sad news of the passing of his wife a couple of days ago, Sister Jihad, please make dua for her. I'm going to come back to that in a few moments. So my point is we're accustomed to being together, to pray together, to hug together. I don't know anyone who hug more than Muslims and hug and kiss. I get kisses from brothers all the time because we love one another. In fact, it is almost an article of faith with us. As the Prophet والسلام, said, لَتَدْكُلُوا جَنَّةً حَتَّى تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَا تُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى تَحَبُوا. You never go to Jannah until you believe, and you never believe until you love one another. So we have relationship with one another. We have Juma prayer. We miss Juma prayer, having our imam come to give khutbah. So also we have rights over one another. Haqqu muslimi ala muslim comes. The right of a Muslim over another Muslim is five. Raddu salam, we have to return the salam. We have to visit the sick, and we have to do the janazah prayer, because doing the prayer of the funeral, Sard kifaya, you know, it's upon us, the Muslims, we have to do it. I want to take a moment to talk about visiting. Believe me, I'm talking about Ramadan. I haven't started yet, but I'm talking about Ramadan. I was in, maybe 10 years ago, I was in Northern Virginia, and we had a program, and we're eating dinner, and a brother came to me and said, Imam Siraj, there's a brother, he's in the hospital, can you make dua for him? I said, sure I can, but how far is the hospital from where we are? He said, not that far. I said, let's go. So we went to the hospital to visit a brother. I didn't know who he was. And so we got to the hospital. The brother said, Imam Siraj Wahhaj is here to see you. And the brother in the hospital said, no, he's not. He said, he really is. He didn't believe him until I said, Assalamu alaikum, and hugged him. And that made all the difference to him. Why? Because we are people who love one another and always, you know, wanted to visit one another. So let me say what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm going to say what Allah said in Quran and what the Prophet said. I'm going to make some statements about fasting and Ramadan and what we're going to do at home, inshallah. So Allah mentioned Quran. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykumus siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. And Allah says something very interesting. Let's just take it one part at a time. O you who believe, fasting is prescribed for you. And I'm going to jump to the end and leave out something. La'alakum tatakun, that perhaps that you would become God conscious, fear Allah. But in between that, Allah says something interesting. Kutiba alaykum usiyam. كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Fasting was prescribed for you just as it was prescribed for those who came before you. Fasting isn't anything new. Fasting is one of the pillars of Islam. And all of the prophets, they fasted. Maybe they fasted a little bit differently. Let me say what the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, الأنبياءُ إخوةٌ لِعَلَّاتٍ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ شَتَّى وَدِينُهُمْ وَاحِدٌ. The prophets, all of them were brothers. The mothers are different, but the religion is one. And what Islam has actually done and proven is that the religion is one. Think about it. You think about how many Muslims carry the name of Musa. If you ask a Jew, who's the greatest prophet? They will say Moses, because God spoke to Moses even as a man speaketh unto his friend. But yet, how many Muslims carry the name Musa or Moses? How many Muslims carry the name Isa, Jesus, or Dawood, David, or Suleiman, or Yunus, or Yusuf? All of these are the names of prophets that went before. How many Christians can you name who take the name Muhammad as one of their names? How many Jews do you know who would name their sons Muhammad? Yet Muslims, we name our children after all of the prophets. What are we saying? is that this religion really is one. I was in Canada a few years ago, and a young Muslim man gave a powerful speech. It was a crowd of Muslims and non-Muslims. And I agree with everything he said, except for one thing in his speech. He said that Islam is the newest religion. And afterwards, I said, you know what? It's a great speech, but Islam isn't a new religion. Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, didn't bring a new religion. Ayyuma akmaltu lakum dinakum, this day have I perfected for you your religion. And really, really the religion is one. So what are we going to do? Can I be honest with you? I want to come to the masjid every day. I do. I miss it. But there are a lot of Muslims who never come to the masjid. I must admit to you that wherever I go around the world during the month of Ramadan, more people come to the masjid. There's something about Ramadan and the masjid. You know, we have iftar every night in our masjid, Masjid al-Taqwa, in Bedford-Stuyvesant. And we have hundreds of people. We eat together. And after that, we pray together. We pray behind Sheikh Hassan. I feel sorry for my family that we're going to be home and they're going to have to pray behind me. Alhamdulillah. I'm not Sheikh Hassan. We love him. But we have to be home and we have to do the very best what he can. And I want to be honest with you. Let me say first what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. من صوم رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever fasts in the month of Ramadan with faith, seeking a reward from Allah, Allah will forgive them their sins. What's in it for me? This Ramadan, what's in it for me? Number one, the development of taqwa. Number two, to get rid of our sins. Now let me take off my imam's hat and put on my mathematics hat. I was a student at New York University and a math major. So I'm fascinated with numbers. And sometimes something is so huge or the distance is so great that you can't measure them in miles and kilometers. And I'll give you a couple examples. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, one day was with his companions and they heard a noise. And he said, do you know what that noise is? He said, no, Allah. Allah and his messenger knows. He said that was a rock that was dropped 70 years ago. It just now in hell, and it just now hit the bottom. How deep is hell? Don't want to measure it in miles and kilometers. But you know, a rock dropped 70 years ago just hit the rock bottom. I'll give you another example. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said that there's a tree in Jannah so big. How big is the tree? How many miles? No. We're not talking about miles. We're talking about, the Prophet said, alayhi salat wa salam, a man riding a fast horse, riding 100 years will not pass that tree. That's how big the tree is. Can I give you one more? I'll give you two more. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, whoever fasts one day, fi sabilillah, for Allah, Allah will turn his face from the hellfire. Listen to this. How many miles? A distance of 70 years travel. And let me give you the ultimate one. How big is this universe? According to the scientists, the universe is expanding. But if you would measure from one end of the universe to the other, you know the distance is? 93 billion light years. What does that mean? 93 billion light years. You know what that means? It means the distance that light travels at 186,000 miles per second. It would take 93 billion years to go to that distance. So brothers and sisters, I'm going to conclude. I want to make this point. Praying Salat al-Tarawih in the masjid is great, especially if you have someone like Sheikh Hassan. It's wonderful. But you know, to be honest with you, that wasn't the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salat wa salam during Ramadan. People prayed separately. One night, the Prophet came out alayhi salat wa salam in the masjid to pray Qiyamul Layl. And some people saw him and they joined him. And so the next day the Prophet came, the word had gotten out and more people joined the Prophet. And the third day, the masjid was packed with people and the Prophet led Salatul Taraweeh. The fourth night, they said that the masjid was overwhelmed with so many people and the Prophet didn't come out. And later on, he addressed the people and said, "I'm not unaware that you were there, but I was afraid that had I continued to lead the Salat, it would become mandatory and you wouldn't be able to do it." So really, it wasn't the sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, to pray Salatul Taraweeh in the masjid anyway. So when he died, والسلام, Abu Bakr became the Khalifa. He followed the same example as the Prophet. And somewhere when Umar became Khalifa, he was in the masjid one day, and he saw a handful of people following this imam or this person and another group following that person. And he said, "I think it would be better if they prayed behind one imam." So he got all of the people together and they prayed behind Ubay ibn Ka'b. Who's Ubay ibn Ka'b? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Istaqbiru al-Quran min arba'a." Learn the Quran from four people. And he said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Salim, Mawla Abi Hudhaifa, Ubay ibn Ka'b, and Mu'ad ibn Jabur. These are the great reciters of the Quran. So when the people prayed behind him, you know what Umar said? Ni'ma bid'ah. What a good bid'ah, innovation. And so you may say, how could Umar do that? Umar don't have a right to do that. The Prophet didn't do it. He did have a right to do it. Let me tell you why. The Prophet alayhi salat wasalam said, "Alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnati khulafa' ar-rashidin mahdiin." It's incumbent upon you to follow my sunnah and the sunnah of my rightly guided khalifa. This is rightly guided khalifa. Abu Bakr, no doubt. Umar, no doubt. Uthman, no doubt. Ali, no doubt. And so, why did Umar do it? Umar knew the reasoning that the Prophet didn't do it. He was afraid that it would become mandatory. There's no question about it becoming mandatory after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so, not only that, many prominent Sahaba were around when Umar had Ubay ibn Ka'b lead the Salatul Taraweeh in Jama'ah, and nobody disagreed with him. So now you got to do it home. So brothers and sisters, I really love you. Miss being with you. Miss being at the ICNA conference. I've been going for years, Washington, D.C., Baltimore, Connecticut, and to look at your wonderful faces. You know something? How blessed we are when we do things in Jama'ah. I sometimes try to count how many times I give salams when we go to the masjid. Hundreds of people praying Salatul Taraweeh. All of these barakah that we get. But Allah made it different now. We have to be home. We have to be safe. One day this trial, inshallah, it'll pass. And hopefully we will be better because of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep all of you safe and be careful out there. And you practice social distancing and make sure that you remain safe. Enjoy yourself in Ramadan. You know what? Can I be honest with you, perfectly honest? There is no month that's more busy for me than the month of Ramadan. Virtually every day I'm in some city, some country, somewhere. And you know what I miss? Years ago, in Ramadan, I couldn't wait to go to itikaf, seclusion, to go away from the people, to go by myself, to get with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, for the first time in many, many years, I'll be able to go into seclusion. And so will you. Enjoy your family. And I have to admit something. My wife will tell you, I never washed so many dishes in my life. I wash dishes every night. You know, we're home. Enjoy the company of your family. Have a great Ramadan. Read the Quran. Do dhikra. pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, interact with your family, and stay on social media. I want to commend ICNA and MAS and CARE and all of those Muslim organizations. I love all of them who are trying to keep us in the loop, keep being involved with webinars and talking to your friends via the internet, via the phone. May Allah bless you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, Imam Siraj, for that beneficial talk. So I just wanted to remind everyone, we will be doing a small Q&A. So if you have any questions, feel free to type in your questions in the comment section, and we will keep track of them and so that the Imam can answer. So our first question that I would like to ask Imam Siraj is, do you have any advice on doing tarawih in the homes, especially for those who don't know so much of the Quran?
that's a very good question. You know, Allah mentioned fataqullah mastata'tum, fear Allah as much as you're able to. Wallahi, if you just know kul hu Allahu ahad, ever you know, you know, now is a good time to start learning. You can actually learn the Quran in your home on the internet. You know, social media, it's very good. I come from a different generation. I admit it. I'm gonna be honest with you. I come from a different generation. There was a time when we didn't have computers. I know your generation can't understand that. It doesn't compute. My three-year-old granddaughter, one day, I was in my iPad. He said, "Grandpa, what are you doing?" Now, she's 3 years old, right? Now, how do I tell a three-year-old that I'm trying to go on the Wi-Fi? So I fumbled it. I said, "You know, I'm trying to go here so I can go here." She said, "Grandpa, do you mean Wi-Fi? You're trying to get on Wi-Fi?" So take this opportunity. We're home. SubhanAllah, take this opportunity. Learn Quran. You know, learn Tajweed. There are many, and I'm sure you give the information where they can go online and learn. And it will be good. So we don't have to always depend on praying behind someone else. We can start depending upon ourselves.
That's great advice, definitely. This is the time to start now. If you haven't memorized surahs before, this is the time to start. And whatever you know, just keep repeating it. That's the best way to learn. So thank you for that advice.
Let me tell you something what one of my daughters said. One day, I was listening to her recite Quran. And she was reciting a long surah. And her name is Sadaka. I said, "Sadaka, where'd you learn that surah from?" She said, "Dad, learn it from you." So what do you mean you learned it from me? She said, "Yeah, we pray behind you, and you recited that song, and I learned it from you." So you never know. Just make effort. You know, honestly, it's effort. The idea is that you want to do better, you want to know more. You know, you're going to get tired of reading the same ayat over and over again. So that should be incentive and motivation to learn more, inshallah.
Okay, we have one more question. How do we create the same atmosphere of ibadah at home versus in the masjid?
Again, say it again.
How do we create the same atmosphere of ibadah at home versus in the masjid?
There's one word that you're saying I'm not catching. How do you...
Is there a bug?
There's something that you're saying I can't hear.
How do we create the same atmosphere of ibadah?
Okay. Well, listen, home ain't the masjid. But when the Prophet alayhi salat wa salam, when the weather was really bad, he said he had the mu'adhin called the adhan, and then he said, "Salu fi buyutukum," pray in your homes. And the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said that a home that's not recited the Quran is like a graveyard. So, you know, we are accustomed to praying fard in the masjid and sunnah at home. But now we have to pray sunnah at home. So just make it. This is our masjid. And alhamdulillah, the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said that Allah gave him something he didn't give the other prophets. And one of the things that he gave them is that the whole earth is a masjid. So our home can be a masjid. You know, certainly we prefer praying in the masjid and jama'ah. But we can't right now. So we make it the best that we can.
This is not so much of a comment, but more so one of the viewers is asking, "Imam, your words are so comforting. Can you please give us some words of comfort to soothe our hearts in this difficult time?"
Yeah, let me say this about my brother Fatih, you know, who died yesterday, rahimullah. How do we look at something like this death? And the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, was a magnificent teacher. He found every kind of way to teach. And one of the ways that he taught is even at funerals, janazas, someone die. And let me give you one example. There's many of them, but let me give you one example. He said, when he saw a person that had died, mustarihun wa mustarahun minhu, relieved or relieving. And so he's provocative. He's doing that because he knows you're going to get a response from the Sahaba. So they say, Ya Rasulullah, what is mustarihun wa mustarahun minhu? What is that? What is that? He said, a believer who dies, they go away from the difficulty of this world, ila rahmatullah, until the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know something? Subhanallah. Fatih is finished with the difficulties of this life, the hardships of this life. He's announced to the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, and then he said, those who death, the earth, the people, the trees, the human beings are relieved from the evil. So what's the idea? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no one can die except by the permission of Allah. And the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said this, and you keep this in mind, that if the nations were to gather together to benefit you, they cannot benefit you except what Allah has written already for you. And if the nations of the world gather together to harm you, they could not harm you except what Allah has written for you. So we know it's the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one of our, you know, essence of faith is to believe that nothing happens except by Allah's permission. And alhamdulillah, we accept Allah's permission, his qadr, we accept it and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the good in this life and the good of the hereafter.
JazakAllah khair, Imam Siraj, for that talk and all your advice and answering our questions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you immensely for your efforts, for joining us tonight, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep your family safe and healthy during this time. So with that, is there any last words you'd like to say?
No, but I love you.
Okay. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you immensely once again. Thank you. That brings us to a close. May Allah subhanahu, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us, our families, and to grant us strength during these difficult times. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all the organizers and the wonderful speakers who took so much time out of their busy schedules to plan and for the speakers to come and share and speak and spread the knowledge of the deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us all to, you know, implement what we have learned, because there is no benefit in learning if you're not actually implementing it in your life and making it a part of your life. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the istiqama to be able to do that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant those that are sick from, you know, COVID-19 a speedy and, you know, complete recovery, and all those that are not, you know, sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevent them from being sick and keep them healthy. And all those healthcare workers that are working long, arduous hours to protect and to those that are sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them and grant them the best in this world and the next. So with that said, I just wanted to say that this was a this whole program was from YM, organized by young people. And so please, you know, if you've benefited from anything, we would greatly appreciate your donations. Nothing is too small. So please donate whatever you can. If you can't donate, then at least spread the word. And with your donations, we would be able to continue to provide beneficial programming. So check ICNA out, check YM out. Look, you know, our social media platforms are shared. You can, you know, go on any of them or visit our website. Also, you can look at ICNA and ICNA Relief, which is doing amazing work for during this time. So with that said, please stay safe, stay healthy, and most importantly, stay indoors. And I'd like to conclude. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I hope you all have a good night. Take care.